Minister. I have to say that it was this act of dismissal by the president of these judges that in substantive constitutions, the independence of the judiciary is firmly granted. The 1992 constitution is in Article 127, where the president cannot dismiss any judge of the Supreme Court in a whimsical manner, in the manner in which Nkrumah did. That was one of the sorry points of our great leader, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. Just a bit of history on the last time there was a treason trial in Ghana. Will there be another one in the case of Kennedy Agyapong? The judge at the High Court today thought that it would not make sense to proceed on treason, but we'll see how it goes. After the break, Atta Akyea will tell us the story of his sleepless nights for 4 days, representing a client and a colleague member of parliament and a personal friend and a member of his own party. Atta was the lead counsel for the group of lawyers that represented Kennedy Agyapong. He's next after the break. Welcome back to the show, and this is Good Evening Ghana. We are coming to you live from Metro TV. Tonight we know that Mr. Kennedy Agyapong, who has been the lead newsmaker since last Monday, has had his freedom. His lawyer is here with us, his lead counsel, Atta Akyea, to tell us the story about how it all happened. Good evening, sir.
It's a
pleasure. Thank you very much for coming.
My pleasure,
and I must say to you viewers that in our research this evening for the history that we just shared, we were under the impression that there's been only one treason trial in Ghana. It was Atta that drew our attention to the fact that that actually was the second one. I can understand that he's been combing all the treason cases for his client. Thank you very much, sir.
It's my pleasure.
Your associate said that you've been in the office for the last 4 days.
Yes.
How did you do that? Did you go home to take a shower, come back every morning?
Well, in my law firm and where I sit as a head of the chambers, I have a built-in toilet and a bath.
Oh, you do?
Yes.
That's very expensive.
Yeah, so I did everything in the office.
Mm.
Yeah, and I was going to go home when you asked me to come over.
Oh, and you have gone home for the first time this evening?
Yes, since Monday.
I see.
Yeah, so I decided to come over and then rush home.
We thank you very much.
It's my pleasure.
How did you get involved? How did you hear the news on Monday that Ken, your friend, has been arrested and became your client and you put a legal team together? How did it work?
One of the things that people do not know that Ken is indeed and in fact a colleague of mine at Addis Adel College.
Oh, you were in Addis Adel too?
Oh, yes. Mm. And Ken was very good in economics.
Mm.
And I was very strong in literature.
Mm.
So, like two village boys who've come to a very strong school, we used to compare notes, and whilst I'll help him with literature, he also helped me with economics. So, we have a long-standing bond. Mm. And if you care to know, the Woyome case, he's been sued.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm the solicitor of record trying to battle that case.
Mm-hmm.
It's toned down a bit because of all the problems that we know.
Mm-hmm.
So Monday, I was just in casual clothes when he called me that he's been invited by the CID, so he wants me to show up with him. I said, well, then come and fetch me because I don't have a car around. So he came over. He went to the CID. They ushered us into the conference room of the Director General. And what was at stake was that he was going to be interrogated on some intervention he made in a radio program, and that's Oman FM, a setup that he owns, and he's come out with very inflammatory statement. The worst of all is his strong assertion that he declares war. And I must say that the police officers were very senior. Indeed, and in fact, the Deputy Director General of the CID was presiding.
Oh, I see.
Yes, and the rest of them, some were taking notes, but they were extremely civil with us. I mean, they gave us tea and coffee, and those who wanted to have those things, they started questioning him. What did you mean that you wanted to declare war? Then he explained. And he drew the attention to the fact that they shouldn't take him out of context. He was sick and tired of the fact that it seems to him that there's selective justice going on. And also,
so you didn't say anything at this stage?
At this stage, I didn't say one word.
He was being interviewed.
So he has the benefit of counsel. In case he should say something which is self-incriminating, don't go further than this. Or this shouldn't go on record.
Was there another lawyer there for him?
Yes, there's another lawyer. And the appeal Kubi
was with you?
He was with me.
Mm.
So, and he explained that, look at the mayhem which is developing. Somebody believes that he's not an electoral officer from Electoral Commission. He has some thugs to help him finger people who should not, register. Whilst the procedures under the law are clear, if somebody shows up to register, don't stop him. If you think he's an alien or whatever problem he's doing to violate the law, just take a form, which is a challenge form, and the body will sit and adjudicate the matter. But the person will be registered. If it's found out that he's not qualified to register, they will just disqualify him. I mean, decency. But if you had a situation in which somebody could just say, no, because of the where you're coming from, account extraction, whatever, I won't let you register. And he will be sacking people. And maybe he has all the kind of funny gadgets with him, or he has some buy, sells, macho kind of thing. What is very funny and a mockery of our law enforcement, setup, is that a policeman is standing there, he won't say anything. The perception is that, these are Neilante boys, a man from the castle who is showing where power lies.
Okay, we don't want to go into that because Neilante is not here to explain. But
no, but that's where...
So this is what Kennedy was
saying. Kennedy was talking about what happened in the...
Ododio.
And so he's saying that, well, if we don't have the protection of law, then defend yourself. If somebody wants to come and mess up with what you're doing, defend yourself. And he explained it to the point that he was just trying to awaken the consciousness of our people, to rise up to the occasion, also for the police also to do their job and all that.
Okay, so after that, what happened?
And they said, well, where is the tape? I said, well, I could call somebody to bring you the tape. So he called and they brought the tape. So immediately he handed the tape over to them. I said, well, we are investigating a case of treason against you, and somebody should bail you. So they brought the statement form. The cautions were done. I also signed, and they said, who is going to bail you? Then Honorable Katie Hammond said he was going to bail his colleague. And look at the traffic situation. That time we were in the neighborhood of about 2 o'clock. The traffic situation, Katie Hammond is living beyond the... I think Hacho area or so. The police were very courteous. They said, we'll take you by our siren.
Oh, they did?
They did, graciously. And then they went to inspect his property and brought him back. So we thought that was the end of the matter, you know. And, you know, the culture of the police and my own problems and all that, I was self-recognizant if he's a member of parliament. But this time around, they said they wanted somebody to bail him. Then we started waiting.
For him to come out.
For them to say, you've been bailed. When we need you, we'll call you.
Yes.
My good man, you were with the police until about 8 o'clock.
Where was he at this time?
He was seated in the conference room with us. And we were virtually under arrest. Because, you know, there's no way that you abandon him and all that. So we starved till about 8, only to be told that, look, you are not going to get bailed. And you need to go to the BNI, the immigration, side of the BNI, area of the BNI.
But was it you that called the MPP people to mass up at the office?
Never. Never.
So how did that happen? How did the MPP get to know that this
was going on? Well, you know, a lot of people came around. I don't know who commanded them there, you know. And they were mailing up. I thought the police would have been, I don't know what to use the wrong word, but... I mean, strategically, I don't think they should have waited till this crowd gathered. If you are going to send a man behind...
The crowd gathered very quickly because our cameras were covering it. Within half an hour, they had gathered.
Well,
it was as if somebody was directing them to do that.
I can't speak on that issue because I was also with him in the room there. But what I was saying was that, you know, when it was about 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, the crowd there was not as serious as when it's a seat at 6 o'clock. And they got some ideas that the guy is not going to be, released. And that's when they started this kind of war songs and that kind of thing.
So then what happened?
Then they brought, an armor car.
To fetch him away?
To put him in there. And they brought these routing vehicles, you know. It was very serious.
What did he tell you before he was escorted into the armored car?
Well, he told me that he's unruffled, that these matters, this kind of police behaviors and all that, it's not going to change his thinking about the fight against lawlessness.
What does the police tell you before they put him in the amount?
That we are sorry. We are no longer going to admit him to bail, as we promised earlier on, but he has to be detained. And they were in conference for a long time before they came up with this decision. They started...
So they took him away?
They took him away.
And you were left to do what?
Well, what can we do? Because of the tear gas and things that were going on, some of the tear gas even entered my eyes and that kind of thing. So we waited until everything quieted down, and then I went back to chambers to prepare for the next day. I didn't go home.
So this was Monday night?
Monday night.
Then Tuesday morning, what happened?
Tuesday morning, we got some ideas that they were going to take him to court. Mm-hmm. But what is very sad for me as a lawyer is that nobody gave us the decency to tell us that Honorable Ken Ohinia Japan will be taken to this court, so go and wait over there or that court. It was a whole kind of cat and a mouse game. So we dressed for court. We went to the Fast Track High Court and waited and waited and waited. Some people gave us some ideas that, look, they are trying to serve you, so why don't you go to the Cocoa first? We had no clue as lawyers.
At this time, you had put together a legal team. Who else was in?
We were two. At all my trial times, we were two.
With Apia Kubi?
With Apia Kubi. So some good Samaritan hinted us that, look, they are taking the guy to the Ajabin court, so why don't you rush to the Ajabin court? Meanwhile, the crowd at the Accra High Court Fast Track area, I couldn't believe it. So I need to sneak into my car and came to Ajabin. When we came to Ajabin, they had not brought him, but you could see huge police presence. So when they saw my car leaving,
High Court.
High Court. They followed my car. Mm. And people were trekking from the high street to Ajabin Kingsway. Mm. It was very serious. So later on, we got some ideas that indeed they were bringing him over. They filed the charges. The judge was there. And the whole proceeding started, but to my utter shock and dismay, that where the level of charges against the man, I couldn't believe that they could come out. I thought it was a joke when they said it was treason. They were investigating a case of treason against him. And they heard the tape. They had charged this guy with treason felony, and attempted genocide. On the basis of what he said on radio, so we're surprised. Where is this coming from? So they started. He said, "Well, we are not going to take your plea. Mm-hmm. My lord, we are here to request that you remand him. Well, we're coming here for a committal proceedings." Thereupon, Honorable the former Attorney General,
are you going to
show up? And I announced him that he's come to join us. So we challenged what they were trying to do because the charge and the facts were not in sync at all.
Was it this judge who said,